Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Rajiv Jain, Professor of Chemistry at Jivaji University, Gwalior. Today we shall study Instruments for Analysis Part 2 under the paper Fundamentals of Analytical Chemistry. So learning objectives of this lecture is different electrical components or different components which are used in the instrument which is known as spectrophotometer for the measurement of emission or absorption. These components, usually these are four components. First component is the sources of electromagnetic radiation, then monochromators. Third one will be the readout device or the cuvette where sample is placed. Last one is the readout device and its amplification. These four component we shall study here. The instrument that is used for the measurement of absorption or emission of electromagnetic radiation are known as spectrometers or spectrophotometers. In these instruments, the principle behind these instruments, working of these instruments, or the laws involved for the analysis or the study of absorption or emission are the same for different spectroscopic methods, but there are slightly difference in their parts. For example, in sources of electromagnetic radiation in the UV region is different, in visible region is different, and in the infrared region it may be different, like glower and Nernst glower. And whereas in nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy, it is the spin of the nuclei. Spin of the nuclei, it may be different. And in case of mass spectrometry, it may be the bombardment by and the fragmentation pattern we study. So laws remain the almost the same, but the part of the instrument slightly differ from each other. The essential components of a spectrophotometer are a source of radiant energy, a system of lenses, mirrors and slits which collimate and focus the beam, a monochromator to resolve the radiation into component wavelengths, a transparent container to hold the sample, and a detector with a readout system. Sources of radiant energy are those materials which are excited to higher energy levels by a high voltage electric discharge or by electrical heating. As the materials return to lower energy states or their ground states, they emit photons of characteristic energies corresponding to E, the energy difference between the excited and lower quantum states. An ideal source of radiation for absorption measurements should emit a continuous spectrum of high uniform intensity over the entire wavelength range of interest. But the intensity of a real source varies with wavelength as shown in figure 2. A stable power supply is needed for comparative absorption measurements when single beam instruments are used, whereas double beam instruments have been designed so that I0 and IT are measured and compared simultaneously. By comparing simultaneously, various disturbances, noise, etc. are eliminated. Sources of ultraviolet radiation. The hydrogen lamp and deuterium lamp are the most common sources of ultraviolet radiation. They consist of a pair of electrodes which are enclosed in a glass tube fitted with a quartz window and filled at low temperature with hydrogen or deuterium gas. When a stabilized high voltage is applied to the electrodes, it results an electron discharge which excites other electrons in the gas molecules to high energy states. As the electrons return to their ground state, they emit radiation which is continuous in the region between 180 and 350 nanometer. Sources of visible radiation. A tungsten filament lamp is commonly used as a source of visible and near-infrared radiation. The filament is heated by a stabilized DC power supply or by a storage battery. The tungsten filament emits continuous radiation in the region between 350 and 2500 nanometer. Sources of infrared radiation. The glower and Nernst glower are the sources of infrared radiation. The glower is a silicon carbide rod heated to about 1200 degrees centigrade. It emits continuous radiation in the range 1 to 400 micrometer. The glower is a stable source. The Nernst glower is a hollow rod of zirconium and yttrium oxides heated to approximately 1500 degrees centigrade by electric current. It emits radiation in the range between 0.4 and 20 micrometer. It is not as stable source as the glower, but one of the limitations of the glower is the requirement of water cooling. Monochromators. The source of radiation, as you have learned in the above discussion, emit continuous radiation over wide range of wavelengths. However, narrow band widths have following advantages. Narrow band radiation allow the resolution of absorption bands, which are quite close to each other. With narrow band radiation, a peak may be measured at its absorption maximum, which increases the sensitivity. This absorption maximum is known as lambda max, and the absorption of narrow band radiation will follow Beer's law to greater extent, because only that radiation which can be absorbed is measured. Polychromatic radiation from the source should be resolved into monochromatic radiation. Monochromatic radiation means a narrow bandwidth or a radiation of a particular wavelength. There are two types of resolving devices, filters and monochromators. Filters prepared from special materials allow transition of only limited wavelength regions while absorbing most of the radiation of other wavelengths. Filter transmit radiation with an effective bandwidth from 20 to 50 nanometer. Effective bandwidth is illustrated in figure 3. Whereas monochromators resolve polychromatic radiation into effective bandwidth varying from 35 nanometer to 0.1 nanometer. As shown in the next figure, that is figure 4, components of a monochromator are an entrance slit which admits polychromatic radiation from the source, a collimating device, either a lens or a mirror, a dispersing device, either a prism or grating, which resolves the radiation into components' wavelength, a focusing lens or mirror, and an exit slit. All of the components in the monochromator must be transparent in the wave range to be studied. As shown in the figure 4, prism resolves the polychromatic radiation into small bands of wavelength, each emerging from the prism at slightly different angles. To direct a particular wavelength of resolved radiation through the exit slit, the prism is rotated until the desired wavelength is focused on the exit slit. Prism materials. While selecting the prism, material used in ultraviolet, visible and infrared monochromators, both transparency and dispersion should be considered. Silica, Prisms of various types are used in the ultraviolet region. Quartz and fused silica prisms transmit radiation down to approximately 200 nm even through a weak absorption band, appears around 245 nanometer. Ordinarily, flint glass shows excellent transmission and dispersion in the visible and infrared regions. Ionic crystalline materials are used in the infrared region. Light atoms absorb at lower wavelengths and heavy atoms at higher wavelengths. Thus, lithium fluoride absorbs strongly around 5.6 micrometer and is used just below this, whereas calcium fluoride absorbs strongly at 8.3 micrometer and is used for the region from 5.5 to 8.0 micrometer. Sodium chloride transmits all the visible and infrared region to approximately 16 micrometer. However, it shows poor dispersion in the region from 1.0 to 5.0 micrometer. Sodium chloride has been the most commonly used material in infrared instruments. However, it has a limitation that it is easily attacked by water. Another material, that is potassium bromide, cannot be used for near infrared. However, it is quite satisfactory for the region from 14.3 to 23.5 micrometer. Detectors are the devices which detect the transmitted radiation from the sample container. After passing through the sample container, means sample is put in some cuvettes and electromagnetic radiations are coming through the cuvette, and reduction in the intensity of the electromagnetic radiation is read out with the help of a detector. Detector generates some electrical signal which we study in different forms. What are these electrical signals? These electrical signals should be read. They should be interpreted, or they should fall on certain things. For example, in case of UV visible spectroscopy, these electromagnetic radiations which fall on certain treated surface have sufficient energy to eject electrons from there, and these electrons in photomultiplier tube give different types of signals. Gratings. Gratings are of two types, that is diffraction and reflection gratings. We have already discussed diffraction gratings. Now in this paragraph we shall discuss reflection gratings. Reflection gratings exhibit a constant angular dispersion over the entire region of radiation dispersed. For example, DEIDA is constant from 200 to 800 nanometer for the gratings used in the visible and ultraviolet regions. Constant angular dispersions gives gratings a clear advantage over prisms. When a constant width exit slit, the gratings monochromator supplies a constant band width over the complete range of application, whereas the band width of prism instruments shows great variation. Lenses and mirrors. Radiation is collimated and focused by lenses and mirrors. Materials used for lenses must be transparent to the radiation being used. In the infrared region, mirrors are used because most materials are not sufficiently transparent to infrared radiation and causes significant energy losses. Sample holder. Sample container is usually of quartz or fused silica cells or cuvettes in the ultraviolet region. Ordinarily, glass or quartz is used in the visible region. Gas cells vary in the path length from 0.1 to 100 nanometer, whereas solution cells have path length of 1 to 10 centimeter. Samples for infrared analysis may be gases, liquids or solids. Infrared gas cells consist of cylindrical glass tubes with sodium chloride, potassium bromide or calcium fluoride windows. Liquids are studied either as thin films of the pure compound or as solutions between sodium chloride, potassium bromide or calcium fluoride salt plates. The plates are separated by 0.005 to 0.1 millimeter for neat liquids and 0.1 to 1 millimeter for solutions. Infrared cells must never come in contact with water. They should be cleaned with organic solvents only. So solids are examined in the infrared as pressed potassium bromide discs or as suspensions in high molecular weight liquids, MULs. Weight liquids which are known as MULs, such as nozole MUL. Cells or cuvettes are usually placed after the monochromator in ultraviolet and visible instruments in order to minimize possible decomposition or fluorescence, which might be caused by other high frequency wavelengths of the unresolved radiation. In infrared instruments, the sample is placed before the monochromator so that it will not hinder the focusing of the radiant beam on the detector. Rectangular cells are preferable in comparison to cylindrical cells. Solvents used in spectrophotometric studies must dissolve the sample and transmit in the wavelength region under study. Common solvents which are used in the ultraviolet and visible regions are listed in Table 2 along with their lower transparency limits. Commonly, carbon tetrachloride, carbon disulfide and chloroform are the most used solvents. The path length of the infrared cell is quite short and the infrared absorption bands have rather low molecular absorptivity. Therefore, fairly concentrated solutions of the absorbing components are required in order to obtain a measurable absorbance. Concentrations of the order of 0.5 to 10 weight percent are common for infrared studies. Quantitative accuracy in the infrared region is rather poor. This generates an electric current which is directly proportional to the radiant power of the electromagnetic radiation. The devices which are used for studying the radiant power of the electromagnetic radiation in the form of generated current are known as photovoltaic tubes or photomultiplier tubes. In photomultiplier tubes, there are anodes and cathodes, and when ejected electrons strike in the form of electric current, that these signals come as in the form of absorption or transmission. Next part of the spectrophotometer is phototube. A phototube consists of an evacuated glass envelope, a semi-cylindrical cathode which has an inner surface coated with a compound with relatively loosely bound electrons such as an alkali or alkaline earth oxide, and a central metal wire anode. A potential difference of approximately 90 volt is applied across the electrodes. The phototube and its circuitry are shown schematically in figure 6. The radiation enters through the quartz windows and strikes the photoemissive surface of the cathode. The photons are absorbed and transfer their energy to the loosely bound electrons of the surface material. The electrons escape from the surface and are collected at the anode, causing current to flow in the circuit. If the electron collection is essentially 100% efficient, the phototube current should be proportional to the radiant power of the incident radiation. The phototube current at a given radiant power increases with applied voltage until a plateau is reached where it is no longer dependent on the voltage. The voltage at this point, called the saturation voltage, represents the point at which all the photoemissive electrons are being collected with 100% efficiency. Phototubes are quite small and required amplification in order to operate any common type of readout device. This is done by placing a high resistance in the phototube circuit and applying the electrical potential difference, that is IR drop, across the resistor as the input to an amplification circuit. The output of the amplifier then is used to drive a meter or recorder. Photomultiplier tubes. In the case of phototubes, so far we have learned the mechanism by which an electron escapes from a photoemissive surface. If the ejected electron is accelerated by an electric field, it requires more energy, and if it strikes another electron active surface, it may transfer some of its energy, ejecting several more electrons. These electrons may in turn be accelerated to another surface and produce even more electrons, and so on. This is the principle of the photomultiplier tube. Each succeeding electron active plate or dynode is at higher electrical potential and thus acts as an amplification stage for the original photon. After 9 stages of amplification, the original photon has been amplified by a factor of 10 raised to power 6. Near infrared detectors. The photoconductive cell is commonly used for the detection of near infrared radiation in the range 0.8 to 3 micrometer. The sensing element is a semiconductor such as lead sulfide, lead telluride, or germanium. Upon illuminating with radiation of appropriate wavelength, the electrons of the semiconductor, most of which are non-conducting, are raised to conduction bands. The electrical resistance drops and a large increase in current is noted if a small voltage is applied. The resistance of the system is such that the current may be amplified and finally indicated on a meter or a recorder. Next part of the spectrophotometer is the amplification and readout of detector signals. The electronic signal generated by any radiation detector must be translated into a form which the experimenter can interpret. The process is carried out with the help of amplifiers, emitters, potentiometers, and potentiometric recorders. For measurement, detector signals must be amplified by several orders of magnitude. An amplifier takes an input signal from the circuit of the sensing component and through a series of electronic operations produces an output signal which is many times larger than the input. The amplification factor is called the gain of the amplifier. The amplifier, input, and output signals are generally electrical voltages. If the detector circuit generates an electric current, the input is taken from the voltage drop across a resistor inserted into the circuit as shown in figure 9. Meter readout. Meter readout, as shown in figure 9, is having an emitter represented as A, which measures the electric current in the output circuit. Using Ohm's law, the output voltage E dash is equal to IR, where R dash is equal to the resistance of the output circuit. Therefore, the following expression may be applied. Meter reading is proportional to I output is proportional to E dash or E or I phototube is proportional to transmitted intensity. The validity of the overall proportionality requires a linear amplification by the amplifier. Quantitative calibration. The circuit shown in figure 9 can be easily modified to compensate for the dark current by introducing an additional equal but opposite signal into the input of the amplifier. The compensated signal is adjusted so that the meter reads zero with no radiant energy striking the phototube. The instrument is then standardized by using a blank solution and adjusting the output signal so that the meter reads 100. This standardizing adjustment can be made by varying the gain of the amplifier, varying the slit width, varying the sensitivity of the meter, or by partially blocking the light beam with a comb device. Thus, the instrument is calibrated so that there are 100 units on the meter from IT is equal to 0 to IT is equal to IE, and these units are linear with respect to the I. A potentiometric recorder utilizes a null point designed by mechanically adjusting to its output voltage to by equal and opposite to the output signal from the detector amplifier as shown in figure 10. Any difference between the two outputs is used to actuate the balancing mechanism. A recorder is attached to the balancing mechanism and this recorder continuously plots the voltage of the null point. The position of the recorder is analogous to a meter reading. Single beam versus double beam spectrophotometers. Two basic instrument designs are used in commercial spectrophotometers. One design uses only a single beam, whereas the other provides a double beam. Single beam operation. A beam of radiation from the source enters the monochromator, whereas it is dispersed by a prism or a grating. As the dispersing element is rotated, the various resolved bands of radiations are focused at the exit slit. The radiation then passes through the cell and on to a detector. The instrument is calibrated from 0% and 100% transmittance, T. The single beam method requires stable, high quality components in the source, detectors, and amplifier for high precision measurements. The instrumental parameters cannot fluctuate between the time of 100% T calibration with the blank and the determination of the transmittance of the sample. Direct reading instruments using meter give immediate readout with an accuracy of plus minus 1 to 3% in transmittance. Single beam instruments are simpler and less expensive than double beam, but they are not readily adapted to recording because of the necessity of calibration at each wavelength. Double beam operation. Double beam instruments employ some type of beam splitter prior to the sample cells. One beam is directed through the blank cell or reference and the other beam is directed through the sample cell. The two beams are then compared either continuously or alternately. Thus, in the double beam design, fluctuations in the source intensity, the detector response, and amplifier gain are compensated for by observing the ratio signal between blank and sample. Double beam instruments are more sophisticated electronically and mechanically than the single beam design and therefore are more expensive. In ultraviolet visible double beam spectrophotometers, the beam splitting occurs after the monochromator front surface mirrors. The rotating sector mirror alternately passes and deflects the beam several times a second and thus splits the beam and also chops it. This chopped radiation is used as the input source for AC amplifiers, which provide amplification stability. An electronic null readout system is employed in this type of instrument as shown in figure. The reference and sample beams alternately reach the detector at intervals which depend on the rotational frequencies of the choppers. The instrument records the ratio of the reference and sample signals. If the radiant power of the two beams are different, the imbalance signal activates a servometer, which drives a potentiometric recorder such that the imbalance signal is electronically nulled by the recorder. The electrical bridge of the potentiometric recorder is calibrated in terms of percent transmittance of the sample, and thus the position of the bridge balance point is used to determine percent transmittance. In this lecture, student, you have learned electronic components of instruments, which is used for the measurement of absorption or emission and is known as spectrometer or spectrophotometer. So any type of spectroscopy you are studying, any method, any type of spectrophotometer you are studying, so you remember the four important components. First component is the source. What is the source of radiation? Source may be different from one spectroscopy to another. Second one is the monochromator. That is the part of electronic part which is used for taking a small wavelength band or a particular wavelength. And third part is the container holder, or the container in which the sample to be analyzed or analyte to be analyzed is placed, through which electromagnetic radiation is passed, through which monochromatic radiations are passed. And the fourth part is the detector, which detects the signal, amplified it, and transmit into the readable form. So by using these components, you can make a table, you write the source. Source will vary from UV spectro, visible spectroscopy, IR, it will vary. But part of the electronic part will remain the same. So by varying these sources, you can very well study different types of spectroscopy. So all the components will remain the same, but there will be slight variations. And also the laws involved in these spectroscopy will be almost the same. So here, another important part here is, first part very important was the radiation, source of radiation. Second was where analyte is placed. So that cell of the analyte is also very important. As in case of infrared spectroscopy, generally the cell of a substance is taken, cell of potassium bromide is taken, sample is mixed with potassium bromide, cesium chloride is taken. So the nature of the cell will vary, but it should be exclusive for that particular spectroscopy. And another very important part is the monochromator. It can be very ordinary prism. It can be different types of diffraction gratings, maybe reflection gratings. Very sophisticated gratings are available, which will give you only a particular wavelength. Then various different types of errors which you observe in the monochromators, then detector, they can be nullified if we take double beam spectrophotometer. In single beam spectrophotometer, there are chances of different errors which arise from beginning from the source to detector. But in case of double beam spectrophotometer, because the beam splitters are there, the beam coming out from the difference and from the sample is compared. So most of the errors which are likely to be there, they are eliminated. So double beam spectrophotometers are these days preferred. Thank you.